This begins take three in the deposition of Dr. Peter F. Infante on the record at 3:42:26.
With respect to the specific exposure that these people, and I'm talking about the plaintiffs, have had to benzene from groundwater contamination, the best data, since the groundwater is still contaminated, would be actual air monitoring in the locations where these people are living. True?
Objection. The best data related to what? Their exposure?
To their exposure.
Well, probably the best data would be related to monitoring the air in their homes. I don't know what the extent to which water is contaminated. So if there was some indication of that, you'd want to measure it in their water also.
So part of the body burden that would go into carcinogenicity would be potential actual swallowing of water contaminated by benzene?
Well, if there was some indication the water was contaminated, I'm not saying there is. You were asking me, I thought, you know, what are all the potential areas you would look at for population or human exposure to benzene in the area?
Ingestion of benzene, in your opinion, adds to the body burden just as inhalation does. True?
But it adds to it, yes. How efficiently it's absorbed in relation to inhalation, I'm not sure.
Are you aware of any of the plaintiffs in this case relying on well water for their supply of drinking water?
I don't know.
Are you aware of any of the plaintiffs in this case consuming any groundwater in any way? And I'm talking about drinking it.
You mean drinking contaminated groundwater?
Right.
I haven't been told they have been doing that. No.
So I guess the major route of exposure would be inhalation, as far as you've been able to discern from what you've learned about this case?
Yes.
Now, getting back to my question about the most reliable measure as being actual air monitoring, isn't it true, sir, that when you start trying to calculate the concentration of vapors in a space like a home on top of a plume, that the calculations that might be made by industrial hygienists or engineers are somewhat less than reliable? Do you think that air modeling is a reliable science?
Oh, air modeling or air monitoring?
Air modeling. As opposed to...
Well, if you don't have actual exposure data, that might be... That would be one way of doing it. Also, if there are scenarios that you can anticipate would occur but may not be occurring today, modeling would be another way of determining what the result of those situations, you know, would be.
I'm sorry, you said something about scenarios that might occur but you don't know they're going to occur. What, can you explain that answer to me?
No, I said that you... Yes, I've said you would... You asked me about modeling, I think, versus measuring air, mm-hmm. did you?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, you would do both. You can do both. I mean, but I'm not an engineer. I think you would model, from my knowledge of this area, you would model a situation where you could anticipate that it might occur, but it isn't occurring now. So that you could then maybe make some estimates of what exposures you would derive from that. That's one way, that's one reason for doing modeling. Or if you were wanting to do some extrapolation, you would model.
You would agree with me, sir, that at best models are estimates. True?
Yes, right.
I'm sure that in your many years in the field, you've seen a number of models turn out to be just completely wrong. True?
Objection.
Well, most of the modeling I look at has to do with dose response modeling.
Okay.
And, okay.
So you don't deal with exposure modeling very often?
That's right.
So you have very little experience with that and can't really assess as to how accurate it might be in any particular situation?
Well, in this situation, I wasn't asked to get into that area.
So you have no opinion about the propriety or scientific reliability of any modeling that might be done with respect to benzene exposure in any of these homes?
Objection.
I think, you'd have to address that one to the engineers in terms of how they come up with the numbers they come up with.
Okay. And you don't hold yourself out as an expert in modeling, true?
Not modeling these environmental exposures, no.
And by the same token, you're not an industrial hygienist?
True. That's true, yes.
All right. Okay, so getting back to the question, the most reliable source of information with respect to actual benzene exposure that these plaintiffs might be suffering as a result of the groundwater contamination would be actual monitoring of the places where they live to determine how much of this stuff they breathe. True?
Objection.
That would be one way of doing it.
That would be the most reliable way of doing it, right?
Objection.
Well, it wouldn't be reliable if, let's say, for example, there could be situations where cracks might occur in the soil so that you would get benzene or hydrocarbon contamination into a home. Let's say that if that wasn't occurring at the time you were there measuring, then it wouldn't be very reliable in terms of estimating what the potential of exposure would be to that household. That you would have to model. What measuring will do, it will tell you, like right now, a snapshot of what the exposures are. And that would be a reasonable way of measuring right now what the exposures are.
I looked at the material that you were provided by counsel for plaintiffs, and I didn't see the word cracks anywhere in there. Where did the information come to you about cracks in the soil resulting in exposure by these plaintiffs? Was this part of your discussion with plaintiffs' counsel?
I did have that discussion, yes, with counsel. And
you don't have any independent knowledge of any cracks or anything like that, do you? That's just something that's out there that somebody else is taking care of, true?
I'm not doing any modeling for any of this. That's correct.
Have you suggested to plaintiff's counsel that the most reliable information would be obtained from actual monitoring in these plaintiffs' homes as opposed to coming up with some model?
No.
And you indicated that monitoring would give you only a snapshot, that is what's happening right now. There are devices available, I'm sure that you know, that would allow for longer term monitoring in these locations where the plaintiffs are living, right?
Oh, yes.
And you could go on for a year or more monitoring to determine what the benzene exposure in these places is, right?
Yes.
And that's been done out in the field, hasn't it?
Has been done, yes.
All right. In fact, industry, for example, some of the defendants in this case where they're making some of these chemicals have area monitors that are in position and working 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, the whole time they're in business, true?
I don't know about that.
Okay. So you don't know anything about the refining industry? And the monitoring that's done by the refiners with respect to benzene?
Objection.
Well, are you talking about stationary atmospheric modeling, you mean, that might be related to some EPA regulation?
Yes, sir.
I don't know the extent to which it's done, has been done, or is done, or will be done down in the area we're talking about.
Or that OSHA would require?
Well, OSHA doesn't require outplant monitoring.
Okay. Well, I was actually referring to implant monitoring, but we'll move on to something else. Benzene occurs in nature, true?
Objection from...
Well, that's what I've read.
Do you know whether or not there's benzene present in this particular room that we're in taking this deposition?
I think the only way you'd know is if you did some sampling for it.
Are you concerned about benzene in this room?
Objection from...
Well, I don't have any indication there's any benzene in here, so, I'm not.
Is there a background of benzene that occurs in city air, in towns around the country?
Yes.
All right. And is there background of the hematopoietic cancers that we've been talking about as being a risk from benzene exposure?
Objection.
Is there a background of hematopoietic cancers? What do you mean by that? Do they occur in the general population?
Well, I mean, do they occur in the general population without any exposure to benzene that's reported or measurable?
Objection.
Well, I would think so.
Did hematopoietic cancers, were they around prior to World War I when benzene production took off?
I would think so, yes.
All right. When is the first reported case of leukemia appear in the medical literature that you know of?
The leukemia period? You mean
leukemia
the first time?
Period.
I don't know.
I take it you don't have any opinions about appropriate techniques for remediation of whatever is in the ground that the plaintiffs are complaining of?
No, sir.
Do you believe that it should be remediated?
Yes.
Is that part of your opinion that you're going to give in this case?
I'm asked to.
What is the basis for your opinion that it should be remediated?
Well, the basis is that you have the potential for exposure to benzene living in that community.
Do you have an opinion as to what the consequences of the exposure are in terms of actual increase in risk of hematopoietic cancer that the people living there actually have?
Well, you'd have some increase in risk. The extent of it, I couldn't quantify it.
And the some increase in risk is based on your belief that the benzene is migrating from the groundwater and getting into the air that the plaintiffs are breathing?
Well, that it will, and that potential exists, yes.
And that is based on the reports that you have from the other experts in your conversations with plaintiffs' counsel about cracks in the ground?
Yes. Well, and Mattson did an analysis of, I think, general exposure.
Have you ever heard of bioremediation?
Pardon me?
Have you ever heard of bioremediation?
No.
Have you ever heard of remediation in place?
No.
Do you agree, sir, that an increased incidence of a reported disease in a particular population does not establish cause and effect between that disease and the exposure?
Objection.
It may not.
I think you indicated that the percentage of benzene in gasoline in Europe is around 5 to 6%, if I recall your testimony correctly.
In the past, it has been, yes. Probably isn't today.
One of the studies that you cited in your report is a recent study out of Australia, published in June of 2001, involving Australian petroleum industry workers. Do you know what the percentage of benzene is in gasoline that they use in Australia?
I don't recall.
Are there any areas that you have opinions in that we haven't addressed today?
Concerning this case?
Concerning this case.
Well, no.
What different risk assessment models are available to estimate the risk to workers exposed to benzene at lower concentrations?
Ejection fraud.
Well, I don't know, you know, how many are available. I can only tell you the ones that we use, the regulatory agency. They're always linear non-threshold models.
So the one that you sort of cut your teeth on and used throughout your experience as a government employee was the linear, say again?
It was a linear non-threshold model.
And so the way that risk assessment works is that you develop a risk indicating that any exposure above zero necessarily increases the risk of the particular disease that you're looking at, right?
Yes.
And that's just a function of the way the math is done, correct?
Ejection fraud.
Well, it's a function of the model that you use.
Right. And when you say non-threshold, that means there's no threshold below which you have safe exposure that people can be exposed to without any fear of getting, in this case, leukemia or non-Hodgkin's lymphoma or whatever.
That's what it means when you say a non-threshold model.
And so by definition, the model concludes automatically that there is no safe threshold for the materials that you're applying it to, true?
That's the assumption that you're using when you, and that's why you adopt that model.
All right. And that is your assumption with respect to benzene?
Well, that's the assumption of any regulatory agency.
Well, we're not talking about a regulatory agency. We're talking about you testifying as an epidemiologist in a lawsuit, and I'm asking you if that's the approach that you have adopted with respect to this lawsuit, that is a linear non-threshold analysis of benzene, when you look at the various populations that you're looking at in connection with this lawsuit.
Well, I'm not doing any modeling in it, but if I were, that's the model that I would use, a linear non-threshold model.
Right. What other materials do they use linear non-threshold models for in the government?
Well, you would use that for carcinogens. I think if you were dealing with something that was not a carcinogen, then you would use other types of models where you would find thresholds.
And so with respect to that model, it's only appropriate with respect to confirmed carcinogens or suspected carcinogens?
Well, if you're modeling a cancer effect, then you use a linear non-threshold model, particularly on epidemiological data.
I'm curious about that because looking at the plyofilm data that you sort of made your name on, I mean, we're talking about guys who were exposed to huge quantities of benzene.
True. Some were.
All right. In fact, many of those workers were exposed to fairly high concentrations of benzene in the course of their job there at the Plyofilm plant. True?
Well, some were exposed to high levels, some were exposed to low levels.
All right. And yet, when you looked at the death cases and you looked at the concentrations that they were exposed to, and their body burdens of benzene, if that's the right statement, you drew a straight line down to zero such that anything above zero would increase the risk of cancer. True?
Right.
And that's the non-threshold linear analysis methodology that the EPA applied to all studies involving carcinogens. True?
Except EPA use what they call a linearized model where they use the upper 95% confidence limit, I believe, whereas OSHA takes its risk off of the maximum likelihood estimate.
So what's the answer to my question? I mean, is it a non-threshold analysis or not that was used in your initial study of the Plyofilm workers?
Well, it didn't. The initial study had to do with it was a cohort study that wasn't related to modeling.
Okay. Maybe I'm thinking about the next one. All right. Now, I want to talk to you about this Australian study. When did you receive a copy of this study?
No, I can't remember how long I've had it.
Do you know where you got it from?
From the internet.
Do you know who pointed it out to you?
I don't recall.
Was it in connection with another lawsuit by another plaintiff complaining of benzene?
I don't recall.
The conclusions of the study based on the data that is reflected in that study?
Well, there are a lot of different conclusions. I guess you'd have to ask me one and then I'll tell you.
Well, do you agree with the statement that those workers who had exposure to concentrated benzene or BTX were more likely to develop leukemia than those who had similar estimated average exposures but encountered the benzene in more dilute forms such as gasoline?
I think they did do an analysis in there related to that, yes.
Objection or responsiveness?
Would you...
That's what the result of that analysis shows.
Yeah. Intuitively, would you agree that if that is true, then the incidence of hematopoietic cancers among persons exposed to concentrated benzene would be greater than those who are exposed to benzene immigrating from groundwater over which they live?
Objection form.
I'm sorry, I didn't follow the question.
Well, would you agree with me, sir, that to the extent there's data on workers who are exposed to concentrated benzene, that it would not apply to the plaintiffs in this case because they're not dealing with concentrated benzene?
Well, there are a lot of factors. If you're talking about extrapolating the results from an industrial study to a community exposed, I believe. That's what you're talking about.
I think that's what we're talking about.
Okay.
I mean, you're, one of the chief studies that you cite in your report on a community study is an industrial study, and I'm questioning you about it.
Okay, but I'm...
So, yeah, that's the question.
Okay, but you're talking about extrapolating the results. That's what you're talking about. I just want to make sure I'm understanding your question.
Wait a minute. Maybe I'm missing something. You did cite the Australian 2001 study in your report on a community benzene exposure case that you've been hired to give opinions in, right?
Yes.
And so you're extrapolating data from this benzene report out of Australia involving petroleum industry workers to a community situation down in McAllen, Texas, right?
Yes.
Okay. So now, you had a question for me?
Yes.
What's your question?
I guess I'm trying to understand your question. Are you talking about extrapolating the results?
All I did was read you a statement from this report that you're relying on and ask you whether or not you thought that was a fair conclusion. And the statement is those workers who had exposure to concentrated benzene or BTX were more likely to develop leukemia than those who had similar estimated average exposures but encountered the benzene in more dilute forms such as gasoline.
So, in other words, with the same amount of exposure, if they got it in, like, more maybe intermittent bursts, it appeared to have more of an effect.
Well, I don't think
that's what it's saying.
Well, it says what it says. And, in fact, do you disagree with their conclusion based on the data that you saw in this report, the conclusion that I just read you?
I'm not disagreeing with that. That's an observation that they made when they did the analysis.
Now, if we're talking about 6% benzene in the gasoline, you'd agree that we're talking about a report in a country where the benzene concentration in gasoline is about 6%, don't you?
I don't remember what they said the content was.
Would you agree with me, sir, that if that's the case, or even if it was only 1.5% as it might be in the U.S., that the concentration of benzene in the groundwater under the plaintiff's houses is much lower concentration than in gasoline?
Objection.
You know, I don't recall seeing it. I don't remember what level the benzene content was of the gasoline or the NAPL that's under the surface.
Well, I think
maybe lower. I don't remember as we're sitting here.
Well, let's look at some of the data. I mean, we're talking about the 1,200 ppm level, right? Benzene in the in the groundwater? You don't remember that?
Well, I'm sorry. I've looked at a lot of data. Now I don't remember it.
Okay, let's see if we can find it. Well, what does OVM stand for in these things?
I have it written down there at one point. It says, what is it? Organic, volatile. What's the last word I have?
Meter? Readings?
Yes.
That's milligrams per meter. I think they ought to give us the... convert 1% to ppm, please. It's 10,000, right?
Yes.
So, if the gasoline was 6% by volume, we would be talking about 60,000 parts per million, right?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have any opinions other than those that are contained in your report about this case?
No.
want to take a break and get a little organized and clean it up.
Off the record at 4:12:22. On the record at 4:25:57.
One of the conclusions in the Australian study was that a 10-year average latency for the cancers that they did find among the petroleum worker population. Do you agree that 10-year latency is what you've observed in your work for lymphohematopoietic cancers resulting in benzene exposure?
Well, that depends on which cancer you're talking about. And it depends on which population is being studied. You can develop leukemia like within a year from exposure, or you can develop it 40 years later in general. I'm talking about acute leukemias. If you're talking about chronic lymphatic leukemia, it has a relatively longer latency period than it can. And it has a longer average latency period than, say, acute myelogenous leukemia.
I want to return to the continuing with the Australian study, 2001 publication. The study purports to be a study of the petroleum industry. What's your understanding of the scope of what they meant when they talked about the petroleum industry? Does that include upstream workers, that is, people on the drilling and production side that would have been around wells?
I can't remember if it's in there or not.
Do you know whether or not that included refinery workers, people who were in the business of making gasoline and other benzene-containing products?
I would think so, yes.
Do you know whether or not it included distribution workers?
Probably.
Do you know whether or not it included office workers that were associated with these various businesses?
No, it may have. I don't remember.
Well, in fact, the conclusion was that they found no increased incidence of any form of cancer among the office workers. Did you recall that conclusion from the study?
I didn't know.
Did you recall that there were 16,000 male workers that they were looking at the time?
I can't recall the number.
Did you recall that... have you looked at the executive summary lately of this 250-plus page study that we're talking about?
I looked at it a few months ago. I might have looked back at it within the last week.
All right. I want to read the introduction to the study, or a section of it, from page Roman numeral 13. Health Watch is a prospective, forward-looking study of all causes of mortality and cancer incidents in Australian petroleum industry that commenced in 1980. A notable finding of the Health Watch program has been the generally low rates for most causes of mortality among the study population. The slight increase in LH cancer was one of the few adverse outcomes, and LH cancer is referred to as lymphohematopoietic cancer. Did you recall that excerpt from the report?
Well, I read it a while ago. Okay.
Do you know quantitatively what the slight increase in the lymphohematopoietic cancers that they detected among their petroleum industry workers in Australia actually was?
I don't remember, because this report that you're looking at there was really a dose response analysis, so I looked at the dose response.
Now, in your report, you talked about the exposure that these various people had had. But in the summary of this report, it talks about the estimated lifetime cumulative benzene exposures were low for the majority of subjects, ranging from 0.005 to 57.3 ppm years, with a mean of 4.9 ppm years. They refer to that as low, and the range is from 0.005 to 57.3 ppm years. Do you consider 57.3 ppm years to be a low dose?
Well, that's the highest they observed in the study, so I would say that's relatively high. It's the highest they observed in the study.
So you consider it to be a high dose?
Right.
Are you aware of epidemiological data that would, in which the conclusion was derived that there was a doubling in incidence of any hematopoietic cancer for, lymphohematopoietic cancer for an exposure in the range of 57.3 ppm years?
Well, in their own dose response analysis, they show elevated odds ratios below that.
Right. And you're saying that there was a doubling of the rate with a confidence interval of 95% in this particular study?
Yeah, the exposure is much lower than that.
Were you aware, by the way, that the Texas Supreme Court doesn't consider 90% confidence interval to be appropriate or satisfactory?
No.
Did you know that part of their conclusion was that no significant association was found between benzene exposure and lymphatic cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, and multiple myeloma or multiple myeloma alone?
In general, they found that, but they did find a significant increase in multiple myeloma in that study in the terminal operators.
Projection responsiveness.
So you disagree with the conclusions that they have stated that I just read to you that's contained in the executive summary of the report that was written by the authors of this report?
I didn't say I disagreed with that.
It goes on to say, the risk of leukemia was found to be strongly associated with both cumulative exposure and average exposure intensity. These metrics are highly correlated in the study population. Individuals with high exposure intensities also had high cumulative exposures, hence it is difficult to assess which of these two metrics is more important. There are some inconclusive evidence that the risk of leukemia is determined more by periods of high exposure than by average exposure, thus implying a nonlinear relationship with exposure intensity. Those workers who had exposure to concentrated benzene or benzene toluene xylene were more likely to develop leukemia than those who had similar estimated average exposures but encountered the benzene in more dilute forms such as gasoline. There again, we're talking about people who were exposed to concentrated benzene as opposed to benzene diluted such as it would be in 6% benzene gasoline. Does that affect your opinion as to the risk associated with benzene diluted as a component of gasoline in groundwater?
Objection.
Assuming gasoline was spilled into groundwater somewhere.
Could I see what you just read?
Sure.
Stated in the abstract there, that's what they observed in their study. So now your question to me is, how does that relate to benzene and groundwater?
Yes.
Well, I mean, the risk from benzene and groundwater would be related to what the exposures were generated from the benzene and the groundwater.
Would you agree with the conclusion, if it were made, that the fact that the benzene is diluted in gasoline and then once again diluted in groundwater, that those factors would reduce the risk to the population that was exposed to the benzene?
Objection. Sure.
Well, I would be my opinion that the atmospheric levels that were generated from the groundwater that would be related to the risk in that dose range.
Objection, Mr. Chairman.
So what this study, I think, is saying is that if you have similar, I think what the analysis actually shows is similar cumulative doses of benzene, the people in the BTX unit that had potential for higher levels of exposure had a higher risk when they matched for like total benzene received. And I think, you know, that's a possibility that if you receive the same amount, but if you receive it through intermittent bursts to higher levels, that you might have a higher risk. So what it's saying is that it depends on the not only your cumulative exposure, but the mode of exposure, how you receive that exposure may somewhat augment the dose response for benzene and leukemia.
Right.
I think that's.
Objection.
I agree with that.
So for example, the Turkish studies, Italian studies, and biofilm studies where workers were dealing with relatively pure benzene compared to what we're dealing with here today. The leukemias and other lymphohematopoietic cancers that were observed in those studies might be the result of the intermittent concentrated exposures to benzene as opposed to the longer term lower levels of exposures to benzene that those workers might have been subjected to.
Objection for me.
See if I understand your question correctly. You're saying there's no relative risk estimates from those studies, so I think you'd have to look at it in terms of relative risk. But, I mean, the people in Italy and in Turkey, they had pretty high levels of exposure. Probably their daily exposures were as high as what those intermittent exposures are in the BTX unit there, if not higher, I would guess. So probably all those exposures, or most of the exposures that the cases at Villiani and Axoy report are probably higher than the exposures of people working at the BTX unit in this study, even when they had high exposures. I'm saying the others probably experienced much higher exposures than those.
Well, and in fact, the Turkish and Italian and plyofilm studies would involve people who would have a higher exposure than if folks who are involved in this case drilled down, took some water out, put it in a bucket, and stuck their face over it and breathed deeply. True?
Not from what I saw those analyses that looking at the what is in the test tubes when they put the test tube right and looked at the airspace above that. Those ended up being pretty high.
The vapor space?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you know how that work is done or how that study is done, the vapor space analysis?
It was my understanding they put the liquid into a test tube and that they let it set there. And then after a period of time, they took a sample from the vapor phase above that liquid.
Okay. Do you have any basis for stating in a careful scientific way that the persons involved in this lawsuit are at an increased risk of any lymphohematopoietic cancer?
Yes.
All right. And the basis for your statement with respect to that are all contained in the report that you submitted to counsel for plaintiffs in this case. True?
Yeah, and I think I mentioned a few other reports earlier that I had.
I'm going to take him again probably later, but I'm going to pass the witness for now. Somebody else wants to take a turn.
Off the record at 4:40:45. On the record at 4:42:04.
Hello, Dr. Infante. My name is Robert Puente. I represent Phillips Properties, one of the defendants in this case. I just want to ask you a few questions just to clarify what you testified to today. You mentioned that benzene is also found in natural gas. Is that correct?
I think I said I didn't know the answer to that question.
What do you think? You
pardon me?
You think it's
found? I don't know.
You don't have any independent scientific knowledge as to whether Phillips Properties caused the purported benzene in the air in this in the area we're talking about today?
I don't have any information specifically about who, how the, which company or whatever was involved in the pollution of the groundwater.
Okay. You mentioned in the cohort study you conducted of the three gasoline mechanics here in D.C., the three African-American individuals.
Yes, what about it?
You mentioned that race may be a factor in causation between benzene and the different various leukemias.
No, I didn't say race was a factor in the causation. I said they were all black males. So okay. Then I estimated the expected based on rates in black males, because you, when you do studies, you adjust for race and sex and age.
So therefore, from a public health standpoint, you make these adjustments for race, also ethnicity?
I've seen adjustments for race. I haven't seen many adjustments for ethnicity in any studies. The only study I'm aware of where there was adjustment made was in, I think, a study of Hispanic, where there was a population that maybe had 30 or 40% Hispanics in this industrial setting, and so they made adjustments for cigarette smoking in the study because Hispanics smoke. They smoke many fewer cigarettes when they smoke than other white males.
As far as incidence for leukemia, is there a difference between, let's say, Hispanics and the general American population?
I don't believe there's much of a difference. If you're talking about background rates, I don't think there's too much of a difference.
But there is a difference, and if there is, what is it? The difference?
I didn't look into that. I'm saying I don't think there's much of a difference, but I can't give you specific numbers.
So your testimony is that there is a difference, but you can't give us numbers as to the differential rates?
No, I'm saying I don't think there's much of a difference between, are you talking about Hispanics in the United States versus
yes.
other white males?
Yes.
I haven't looked at the data recently, so I don't think that, but I don't believe when I did look at it, there's much of a difference.
Okay. The overwhelming majority of the persons bringing the lawsuit are Hispanic origin. Would there be a difference in your approach to your study or to your conclusions based on this that's
no.
not found in your report?
No.
And why is that?
I don't think there would be, I don't think they'd have any difference in their risk from exposure to benzene.
Okay. What are the other causes of leukemia?
Well, radiation, ethylene oxide, there are some anti-neoplastic agents or anti-cancer agents, and perhaps butadiene.
And you can't state because you have not been in the county and you have not conducted direct testing that these various agents that you just mentioned are not present in the area?
Well, I would doubt it, that you could measure them in the air. I would doubt you could measure them in the air.
And this is based on your experience or based on what?
Just based on knowledge of where these chemical exposures occur.
And where do these chemical exposures occur?
Well, ethylene oxide is mostly where people would be exposed to it would be mostly individuals that work in hospitals that do autoclaving of surgical instruments, or that work for some, you know, major spice companies that that do sterilization.
You can rule out that none of the persons bringing a lawsuit have been exposed to these agents?
Well, I would doubt that they have been, certainly. I mean, there's possible one of them could work in, work in a hospital and be a sterilizer operator and have some exposure. Those exposures are pretty well controlled now since ethylene oxide was regulated. So, I mean, it's you know, possible one of them could have a job there, or, you know, working for 3M or something where they might be manufacturing medical equipment. But 3M's pretty sophisticated in terms of its engineering, so I doubt if there's much exposure to those employees anymore.
Yeah, you mentioned your report, clear and substantial risk. What exactly does that mean in numeric terms?
Where did I mention that?
In your report here, that in the last page. It is abundantly clear from the literature discussed.
Excuse me, you're on the last page?
Yes.
Okay.
All right. Creates a clear and substantial risk to the persons or persons involved. I think you might have mentioned that. I might have not heard what you mentioned with reference to what, how many times more does a person who lives in this area is likely, or the risk factor in terms of contracting these type of diseases? Is it 5 times more, 10 times more? What is the number?
You couldn't answer that question until you had specific information on what their exposure levels were.
Okay. But you have enough confidence to say it's a clear and substantial risk, but you don't have a numeric
right
percentage as to risk.
That's right.
What more would you need to find out in order to make more of a probability assessment of what the risk factor is?
Well, you would look at the, what their, you'd have to determine what the exposures are to the population, and what the potential exposures are to the population. And then you would have to look at the population in terms of, what their health status is compared. All these studies we're citing here today are based on healthy blue-collar workers that had to pass a physical examination to be employed at an industrial facility. And then you're extrapolating those results to the sick and the infirmed and children that live in the community. So, I mean, you'd have to, have some idea about those factors in the community also.
Objection, not responsive.
So given those individual factors, given in that you don't have this information for each of the individual persons bringing a lawsuit, it's really difficult for you to put a number as to what the individual risk for each of the persons bringing a lawsuit is in terms of contracting these types of diseases.
That's correct.
Okay. The OSHA, I think, level is 1 ppm in 1987. Is that the current level now?
Is an 8-hour time-rated average, yes.
Okay. And you, I believe, mentioned in your report that in your scientific opinion, levels lower than that have a causal relationship or correlation with these type of diseases. Is that correct?
Yes.
Is that the general consensus in the scientific community?
Well, those are what the studies are showing.
But is that the general consensus?
I haven't taken a poll to know what the general consensus is.
Are you safe to say that that is the general consensus?
Well, even when OSHA promulgated its final standard, we never said that was a safe level, according to OSHA's own policy. In terms of what it considers significant risk, we would have had to go down at least a 0.1 part per million. Sure. But we couldn't do that because we were constrained by feasibility. So even OSHA, at the time it promulgated that new standard, left behind a risk that the agency considered significant.
Is the 1 ppm more representative of a consensus within the scientific community than the percentages you were proffering today, given the difficulty in arriving at a consensus?
consensus for what?
In terms of creating the level by which a level above or below is violative of the regulations of OSHA.
Well, one part per million is the regulation, but no one ever said that was a safe level. That's not based on health. That's based partly on health, but then it bottomed out on the basis of economic feasibility.
But that's still the number today, is it correct?
That's the regulatory level for the workplace, yes.
Okay. But that number is not arbitrary. It's there for a reason, is it correct? Is it there because it represents a consensus within the scientific community as to a level by which, a threshold level for worker safety?
No, it doesn't even represent a level within OSHA, who promulgated the standard that was any threshold level. It bottomed out because of feasibility. We concluded there was a risk at least 10 times of what the agency considers a significant risk when it promulgated the one part per million limit.
Because I'm just trying to understand from, I guess, a lay point of view, if it's one PPM and that's OSHA, but you're saying it's not safe, why is it still one PPM?
Because it couldn't go any lower because of feasibility. We set standards, right, to the extent feasible to protect men and women in the workplace. So we could only go to one part per million because of constraints of feasibility.
So you're arguing that levels now, which are below the feasible level that you just mentioned, are causing or will cause in future leukemia in this area?
That is a substantial risk. The feasible level we were talking about was for feasible in the workplace at the time the standard was promulgated. I'm not talking about environmental exposures in that standard. That applies to workplaces.
Okay, so for the workplace, a higher level, but for the community, a level that OSHA would not recommend, or a level that OSHA does not have as its threshold level.
Yeah, OSHA doesn't regulate general environmental exposures. EPA does.
Okay. You mentioned benzene studies, not a lot of statistical power in most of the studies. What did you mean by that?
Well, there aren't a lot of individuals. Leukemia and lymphoma, they're relatively rare diseases. So you have to study a lot of people in order to be able to have enough statistical power to detect an adverse effect if, in fact, one is present.
So these studies do not have statistical power because of the low amount of persons studied?
Depending on which study, they don't have a lot of statistical power, yes. And as you start to look at specific individual causes of death, you have less and less statistical power to evaluate the risk from each cause.
Can you explain in lay terms what you mean by statistical power? Does that mean an ability to explain what may happen in the future based on what you measured in the past? Or
no, statistical power has to do with the ability to detect an elevated risk if, in fact, one is present.
Okay.
So how much power do you have in the study to detect a risk if it's present there?
You're basing many of your conclusions on these incomplete studies, on these benzene studies, which you just said do not have a lot of statistical power.
I said they didn't have a lot of statistical power. I never mentioned that they were incomplete studies.
Okay. Well, thank you, Dr. Infante. I have no more questions.
Okay.
It's been a long afternoon. Thank you.
All right, you're welcome.
Off the record at 456.03. On the record at 456.48.
Dr. Infante, my name is Keith Ewells, and I just have a few questions for you. And for the most part, I'm going to follow up on some things that were asked you earlier and make sure I'm clear on what your testimony is. So I'm going to apologize in advance for jumping around a little bit, okay?
Okay.
As I understood your testimony earlier, you talked about two types of epidemiological studies, one being cohort studies and one being case control studies. Are there other types of scientific methods to study the effects of benzene on either individuals or populations?
Well, you could do descriptive studies which would essentially be studies of, say, populations that, you know, aren't industrial populations that might live in an area. And you can do case studies, which would deal with aspects like Axel and Villani have published over the years, looking at various types of blood diseases and their progression to other types of blood diseases in related to benzene exposure. So those are that's the four types of analyses you could do in people related to benzene toxicity.
And as I understand it, in this case, you have not done a cohort study, correct?
No, and there's one more type of study you could do. You could also do studies, which is, there are a number of these studies available in the literature looking at chromosomal breakage or damage to DNA from workers exposed to benzene.
And what kind of study would you call that?
Well, these are epidemiological studies, and there are also some toxicological studies that relate to cytogenetic damage.
Chromosome damage?
Chromosome damage.
Have you done any cohort study in this case related to the population of either the plaintiffs themselves or to the plume area?
No.
Have you done a case control study related to this case?
No.
Have you done a descriptive study related to this case?
No.
Have you done a case study related to this case?
No.
And I assume you haven't done this type of literature search on chromosome damage that you talked about as your fifth type of study for this particular group of plaintiffs or this particular population?
No, I have not. Could be an interesting study to do that. Think about that.
As I understand your testimony today, you're saying that the population of in this plume area have an increased risk of leukemia and these other types of cancers we've talked about, correct?
Yes.
But you cannot quantify what that increased risk is, correct?
Yes.
And I believe your testimony was that you would need specific data from the homes or businesses that these people occupy in order to quantify that risk, correct?
You'd have to have some estimates of their exposures, yes.
And since you don't have evidence of the exposures, would you agree that you don't know if this increased risk is significant or insignificant?
Objection.
I'm not quite sure what you mean by significant. There's an increased risk. I mean, there's not only from like future exposures, like what's going on from today forward, but also, you know, from the past exposures. And I don't, like I said, I don't know what that is because I don't know what those exposures are.
And you can't quantify it in any shape or form, correct?
I haven't done that. I suppose, you know, maybe one could do it.
And you said to do it, though, you would need some specific data from air sampling from the homes and businesses where these people live and work, correct?
That would be one way of doing it.
And what would be another way of doing it?
Well, you could take information that, you know, was available from people that are you know, doing modeling or take actual exposure monitoring data.
Okay, and Mr. Warner asked you questions earlier about modeling, and you indicated that the specific data from testing is more reliable than the modeling, correct?
Objection.
I don't believe I said that. I said for knowing what's going on right today, if you go out and take atmospheric samples, you know, that would provide you with a snapshot assessment of what the exposures are. If you could anticipate some events taking place that have not, you know, that haven't taken place where you're monitoring, then you could use modeling to estimate that if those events take place, what the exposure would be for the future.
Okay, and in this particular case, you have not done that, correct?
That's right.
You made a statement earlier. I want to see if you could explain to me. You said that there is not a lot of statistical power in any of the benzene studies. What do you mean by that?
Well, if when you, what I mean by that is that statistical powers I just mentioned, my previous question has to do with the ability to detect an effect if in fact one is present. Now, the larger group of diseases that you look at, the more statistical power you have because you have more data on that. When you start to split the benzene-related diseases down into finer and finer subgroups, and then you split it into finer or finer exposure levels, then you have less statistical power to be able to see an effect from those exposures. That's what I meant by that.
So the benzene studies that have been done have, for the most part, been done on relatively small populations, correct?
Except for the Chinese study. It's larger, and even that, when looking at some of the cell types of leukemia, the data get a little thin.
And when you have small populations and the data gets thin, those type of studies are subject to more type of interpretation and potentially more error, correct?
Objection.
I don't know what you mean by interpretation, but if you have few observations or you have a small data set for a particular exposure level, then you have little statistical power to detect an effect from that exposure if in fact one is present.
So, just as an example, if you had a particular exposure of 10 people and you had one person that, let's say, you had some type of positive data from, that is not as reliable a sample as if you had 100 people that you were looking at, correct?
That's right. In terms of power, you would have, if you have the more people you look at,
because
providing everything else is the same in terms of the quality of the study and the methodology, you would have more statistical power. But power is the ability to detect an effect if, in fact, one is present.
Because
so you're concerned about not finding an effect if you don't have statistical power. On the other hand, you could find an effect in a low power study, but that's not related to power.
Objection responsiveness. If you had a positive finding of one person out of 10, you could look at 90 other people, have a total population that you're looking at of 100, and still end up with one out of 100, correct?
One out of 100 what?
With positive findings.
Well, I mean, studying 100 people, I don't think, would... It wouldn't make much sense. You wouldn't have enough statistical power to do that. I mean, you got a background rate for leukemia overall of like 8 per 100,000. So, I mean, if you studied 100 people, you wouldn't expect to find any.
But in any event, one of the...
If you studied 100,000, you'd expect to find 8, given that background rate. So...
In any event, one of the problems in looking at these studies on benzene is there is not a lot of statistical power, correct?
That's one of the limitations.
And therefore, when you try to extrapolate these studies, you have to be careful, correct?
When you try to interpret studies that don't show any elevated risk.
And even studies that do show elevated risk, if you're looking at a small population, they may be grossly overstated, correct?
Well, that's why you're looking at alpha error for that. That's why you're looking at your probability. So if it's statistically significant, that deals with that. So that's not a power problem. Power, like I said before, is the inability, or is the ability to detect an effect if in fact one is present. So if you find an effect that in the study, then it's significantly elevated, then you don't have to deal with power in that study. You deal with alpha error, not beta error.
If I understand your testimony earlier, you have no opinions regarding the cause of this particular plume, correct?
I don't know what all the contributing sources were.
And you have no opinions on who contributed to the plume, correct?
That's right.
No opinions on the size of the plume?
Well, as my understanding, it was something like, 25 acres, I believe, of water below the ground that was contaminated.
And that's something that you're relying on someone else for, is that correct?
Well, yeah, I mean, I didn't do any measurements there.
Okay. And you have no opinions regarding the personal make, I'm sorry, the chemical makeup of the plume, correct?
Well, there's some analyses that have been done, I think, on the, of the, what, the napple and the gasoline, I believe.
But you yourself have no opinions on the chemical makeup of the plume, correct?
I didn't do any analysis, if that's what you mean, of the chemical makeup of the plume, that's correct.
And you have no opinions and have done no analysis on the hydrology of the plume, correct?
I haven't done any analysis on the hydrology.
And you haven't looked at any of the specific defendants in this case, for example, my client Gulf, to see if there's any evidence that Gulf or anybody else caused or contributed to this plume, correct?
That's right.
Testified earlier that you would not warn the plaintiffs in this case or to move out of this area based upon your knowledge of this particular case, correct?
Objection.
I said that's not in my purview in this case.
And I think you said that the purview would be left to the state agencies to warn people to move out of this area, correct?
Objection.
Well, I didn't say anything about moving out of the area. That question was raised, I think, to me. It's up to the state agency to make the determination for the individuals that live there. I haven't addressed that at all, nor am I going to.
Okay. And having worked in government for many, many years, you would trust the state agencies to make that recommendation, is that correct?
Cheers.
Well, they're the ones to make the recommendation. When you say, would I trust them to make it, you mean to make the correct recommendation?
Sure.
I don't know what, I guess I don't.
Okay, and you don't have any particular experience with the TEQC in Texas, is that correct?
TCEQ.
What's the, I don't know what the letters stand for.
Well, let's just say the Texas agencies, governmental agencies that are charged with environmental health, you don't have any experience with them, is that fair?
Not related to this case, no.
Okay. And you don't have any reason to believe they wouldn't make the correct recommendation in this particular case?
I don't have information to one way or the other.
But you would agree with me that there are government agencies in every state, and in fact there are federal agencies too, that are charged with responsibilities for warning people of different groups, whether it's workers or individuals residing in a neighborhood of various health risk.
Well, I mean, there should. I mean, I don't know how often government agencies recommend about health hazards of people in certain areas. I haven't dealt with that particular issue.
Well, then why is it that you testified earlier that it wasn't up to you to tell these people who hired you what their health risk were? Instead, it belonged to the state agencies.
I thought the question posed to me was, should it be up to me to tell these individuals whether they should move or not? I'm saying that's not, you know, that's a social decision that a lot of factors go into.
You said that that's something that belongs to the state agencies. And so why do you say it belongs to the state agencies and not to you?
That's a decision for whatever the laws are in the state of Texas.
Okay, and so it's also would not be the responsibility of my client Gulf or any of the other defendants in this case to make that decision, correct?
I guess that's up to Gulf to decide what it wants to do.
And just like it's up to you to decide whether you want to tell these people that hired you what to do, correct?
Except he didn't cause the pollution.
I wasn't asked.
Objection, sidebar.
I wasn't, asked to, go into this area, so I don't have any comments on it at this time.
other than the fact that it is a state agency's responsibility, correct?
Objection four.
It's a state agency's responsibility.
Where is butadiene found?
There's some exposure in the rubber industry.
Any place else?
That's about it. Styrene butadiene rubber manufacturing.
You worked for OSHA for many years, correct?
Yes.
Who is it in OSHA that makes the final decision on a threshold standard like one part per million for benzene?
Well, first of all, I don't know what you mean by a threshold standard. I think I testified earlier that no one ever said that was a threshold or a safe level. In fact, by the agency's own policy, it isn't. But that final determination is made by the assistant secretary.
Okay, objection responsiveness. Is the determination made by OSHA by the assistant secretary for the one part per million OSHA standard for benzene?
That's who made the decision, yes.
Okay, and it's your testimony that that standard is not safe, correct?
Absolutely, and by OSHA's own policy it isn't.
And how many years did you work for OSHA?
24.
And one of your responsibilities at OSHA was dealing with benzene?
Yes.
And did you ever make any recommendations to the assistant secretary of OSHA that the standard for benzene be lowered?
Well, the risk assessment showed that you would have what the agency considers a significant risk at 0.1 part per million. And the agency knew that. But the data that were before the agency and interpreted by the agency was that it was not economically feasible for the companies to get below one part per million. So that was the final limit that was promulgated.
Objection responsiveness. Did you ever make any specific recommendations to the assistant secretary of OSHA to lower the standard for benzene from one part per million?
I was involved in the risk assessment that shows what's my job.
So would the answer
to show what the risk is?
And
the answer would be yes, everybody knew what the risk was based on the agency's preferred risk assessment. And it showed what the agency considers a significant risk, even down to 0.1 part per million and maybe even lower.
And what was the specific recommendation that you made to the assistant secretary of OSHA regarding the benzene standard?
The analysis provided indicated what the risk, what the occupational lifetime risk was from various levels of exposure. And the assistant secretary knew that.
And what was your specific recommendation regarding what the standard, OSHA standard, should be for benzene to the assistant secretary?
Objection, asked an answer.
Like I say, I provided data on the dose response that dose response that everybody knew about showed a significant risk at 0.1 part per million.
And so did you recommend to the assistant secretary that the standard be lowered to 0.1 part per million?
I wouldn't have needed to. I was involved in the risk assessment that showed that risk. It's up to the agency then. It becomes a policy decision. It's not based on health science anymore.
So the truth of the matter is you never made a specific recommendation to the assistant secretary to lower the standard below one part per million, did you?
Objection asked and answered.
That distorts my what I just testified to. Well, sir, I said I indicated what the risks were
and, sir,
at the various levels, so and everybody knew.
Objection responsiveness. So the truth of the matter is, sir, is that even having your risk assessment in hand, the assistant secretary decided that the appropriate standard was one part per million, correct?
Based on feasibility, yes.
Now, you yourself have not done any air sampling in the McAllen plume area, correct?
Objection asked and answered.
Have answered that question.
The answer would be no.
The answer is no.
And you have not reviewed any air samples for the McAllen plume area, correct?
Correct.
And you have not yourself analyzed any of the samples of free products in the plume area, right?
Correct.
Asked and answered.
And I noticed one of the documents in your file was the copy of the petition in this case, correct? Back
I don't know if by that name, but maybe.
Start at PI 165, I think that is the plaintiff's 10th consolidated petition, and that has a list of the various plaintiffs in the case. You recognize that at the top?
I see it here.
And my question's real simple. You don't have any specific opinions as to benzene exposure of any of those specific individuals, correct?
Correct.
Benzene is trapped below a layer of water. Will the vapor penetrate through the water into the air?
Well, you'd probably be better off to ask an engineer the answer to that question, but I would think the benzene would float to the top of the water, and then you'd get some evaporation.
Okay. If the benzene, if you have a water and then a layer of clay, then an airspace, and then the whatever product that contains the diluted benzene. Would the benzene vapor go up through the air, through the clay, through the water, up into the air?
Well, you're getting out of my area of expertise now.
Okay, that's fine. Is it your opinion that the appropriate health standard for benzene exposure would be 0.1 parts per million over an 8-hour time-weighted average?
Objection.
It should be lower than that, based on health.
Even though your risk assessment data that you provided to the Assistant Secretary of OSHA showed 0.1?
What I said was the risk was an extra leukemia death per 1,000 at 0.1 parts per million.
I don't have anything further.
Off the record at 5:22:04 and 5:31:06. This concludes take three in the deposition of Dr. Peter F. Infante. We adjourn for the day at 5:31:23.